it is 6BTY. And I've also got one of these SDR dongles, the HF one. So I haven't played a bit with it, but not massively. But Hans approached me and he said, can I give him some indication of antennas, that there'd been some questions, what do you use? And my immediate reaction is active antennas. That's still my reaction, but Hans said, but what about other things? Aren't there other possibilities? And I will have a look at that as well, just briefly. But they're not really suitable for the project that Hans asked me to talk about, and that is for this noise monitoring issue. Yeah, okay.
Sorry,
I'm inclined to talk away from this thing and then into it, so sorry about that. Okay, scope of what I want to talk about. First is receive only, clearly, SDR receivers. I'm assuming it's a 50-ohm receiver. They are, usually. And that you want antennas that will fit into a suburban environment. I can talk about antennas that if you've got a farm, then we could make use of them. This is not really applicable to what you guys want to do. HF, obviously, 1 to 30 megs. I've said 1 to 30, but 3 to 30 is the formal definition of HF. But you can even go lower than 1 meg with most of these SDRs. Medium wave is nice as well. And as I mentioned at the start, aimed at the noise measurement problem. So that is going to sort of frame, which one is the button at there? That is going to frame the work. But it's aimed at the noise measurement project, but where it will apply to other things, great. Now, given that background, what are the design constraints? What do you need to keep in mind when you start to design like this, or think about what's possible? The first one is wavelength, from 1 to 30 megahertz. If you start at 30 megahertz, at 1 megahertz, you're talking about a wavelength of 300 meters. And if you want a quarter wave vertical, there you got it, 75 meters high. And that straight away puts it out of the bounds of a suburban plot, or at least most of us. If you live on the plots outside of the town, yeah. Antenna pattern. If you want to do noise measurement, you want at least reasonably consistent pattern. Otherwise, you don't know what you're measuring. And certainly in a calibrated environment, you need a calibrated antenna pattern. Now, if you have, in many cases, antennas will vary considerably. And I'll show you some pictures shortly. They will vary considerably over the HF band in terms of their pattern. So that is a very big constraint, the pattern variation. From a noise measurement, you want it omnidirectional, and when the pattern varies widely, it's not omnidirectional. The antenna impedance, obviously, will vary as well. And I mentioned earlier that it's a 50-ohm, I'm assuming a 50-ohm receiver. So an antenna that varies from anywhere from a very high impedance to a very low impedance and anywhere else in between, resonant, capacitive, inductive, you name it, if you choose the wrong antenna. And then another very big consideration is environmental noise. Now, we want to measure man-made noise caused by us or by our neighbors. Environmental noise is a factor, and it's to some extent a helping factor, because it simplifies your work at lower frequencies. There's no point in designing an antenna or four-ramp situation that measures substantially below environmental noise. If you're working in a mine, underground, different story. Environmental noise is just about non-existent only. And you have to consider noise. But we're not talking about that, we're talking up here on the ground. And environmental noise is information is available in a thing they call FA, which is effectively the noise figure of your antenna relative to background noise which you would get in a resistor. Background noise in a resistor is minus 174 dBm. Don't ask me what that is in microvolts, but in terms of power, it's milliwatts, minus 174 milliwatts in a 1 hertz bandwidth. And there are charts of that available. the equations to actually do that calculation. What is the field strength? You know, in this case we want to, let's say that's 1 hertz bandwidth, so that D would be 1 hertz. You plug it into this formula and you use that number which you get from the charts, it will give you a field strength in volts per meter. If you want to go into that, that's more for information at the moment. But, and incidentally, this is from the CCR or CISPR or whatever they call themselves. Forget that ITU, the other name. That's the typical chart for HF noise, right up into VHF region as well. And you can see here, this is relative to what you would expect from a resistor. And it is considerably above. You're sitting up here at 160 dB noise figure at the low frequency. That is 10 kilohertz over there. We worried about 1 meg, which is about there. But even here, you're sitting between 60 and 100 dB above environmental noise. In other words, if you get a nice, good quality HF receiver, it might have a noise figure of 6 dB. That would be sitting down here somewhere. There is no point in breaking your head about noise figure on your antenna when you're wanting to receive it 1 megahertz. Environmental noise is way above. You will not receive anything that isn't at least above that. You won't know about it. It's buried in the noise. However, when you go to 30 megahertz, there's 10 megahertz, 30 megs around there. Now you have to start thinking about the noise figure of your receiver and of your system. So in that region, you worry about noise. Yeah, you can certainly forget about it. Not totally. You need to keep it in mind because you can make some big screw-ups and end up with bad noise from your antenna. But broadly speaking, that's where you worry about noise. In this area, you worry about other things. That's what you worry about. Powerful broadcast stations. Now, your SDR receiver, the one I've got, will go down to 300 kilohertz. So the medium wave band is there and it's wide open to that. So unless you filter it out, you've got these massive, powerful transmitters. On the East Rand here, we've got LM radio, which is on 702 kilohertz. 50 kilowatt?
Yeah.
Yeah, into a full wave quarter wave, full size quarter wave vertical. So it's a powerful transmitter in your backyard. On shortwave, you've also got big transmitters, most of them further away, but still, Meriton is not that far away. But a lot of them will be skipped to you, but as much as they are skipped to you, you've got the long distance ones coming in from Europe and North Africa. So broadcast stations is the major issue, and those are your problems at the lower frequencies. So when I said the other things you have to worry about, yeah, that's your broadcast stations. And your amplifier, or your antennas, your receiver as well, by the way, has to be able to cope with big broadcast stations here and very small weak signals here, if you want to do realistic measurements. So that sets the sort of background. Any questions on this noise issue?
So are you saying we're going to have a non-linear, sensitivity requirement for the actual noise measurement?
It's not that it's a non-linear requirement, it's just you will not be able to measure below that line.
Okay. Alright, yeah.
And let's say for argument's sake, if you build a receiver, now as they typically will do, the noise level increases towards the low frequency.
Yeah.
Flicker noise, various things like that. Mm-hmm. There's no point in breaking your head if your flicker noise is at least 10 dB below that. And that is your minimum.
Okay.
That line there. You will not easily experience noise levels below that. So that's your sort of bottom line if you want. And if as long as your receiver noise is below that line, say ideally about 10 dB below, you're okay. So keep that in mind if you want to design your own circuits, because that is a minefield, is getting the noise performance design correct. And that will also differentiate various types of receivers that you might find. Not receivers, antenna. Preamplifiers.
So okay. On that subject, very quickly, what's the difference between the expression noise figure of an amplifier and noise factor?
Mm-hmm. caught me out there, I can't remember offhand. Noise figure is defined as signal to noise in and signal to noise out. So that is noise figure. Noise factor, I think they're talking noise factor here.
Is it inherent noise?
Yeah, that is relative to environmental noise. In practice, it's as if your signal, your antenna had a noise figure. So in here, the minimal difference. Okay, the broadcast station. Now, your problem here is you can filter out, for example, the medium wave stations quite easily. If you're not interested in measuring them, HF, so forget them. You can filter out, high-pass filter. Capacitor will take that out, but your shortwave station is a different matter. Mm-hmm. And your own station on your own property, as Hans said, turn the thing off while you're on HF, and turn it on again afterwards. You're not easily going to solve a very, very powerful transmitter writing store. Now, let's just look at some of the options for antennas. And I want to run through these quickly because they don't fit the bill. If you take a full-size broadband antenna, now the classic one that would do this type of job beautifully is a discount antenna. It works very, very well at VHF. You see them quite often. Now, a full-size disco at 80 meters, I'm not even going down to 1 meg, 80 meters would be 19 meters high and 22 meters in diameter. Not an antenna that you could easily put in your backyard. So, because of that, you can, to a large extent, discount any full-size HF antenna. Because it has to be of the order of half a wavelength or a quarter wavelength at the lowest frequency, and we've mentioned that, 75 meters. So that takes out any of these full-size broadband antennas. There are lots of them, and they're just not applicable in this arrangement. But they would be ideal if you could. And if you are measuring at VHF, as mentioned earlier, then those are the type of things to use. Discount is a very good one. But if you wanted to do it for satellite work, you might want something that's pointing up. That there are spirals, log spirals, all kinds of things. Okay, so I'm going to move on from them because they discounted simply on the basis they don't fit in your backyard. The other type of antenna, I've seen it mentioned actually on some of the SDR websites, is effectively a long wire antenna. Take a piece of wire, they sell you I think it's usually a 16 to 1 or a 9 to 1 mini circuits transformer. Work beautifully for receiving. And you swing that out in your backyard, and it'll work. Now, what do we mean by long wire? It's long at the highest frequency. So let's say you've got a backyard that's 20 meters long. So you've got a 20 or 30 meter piece of wire strung out. And at 10 megahertz, at 30 megahertz, that's a long wire. It's multiple wavelengths. But in reality, what you require for that type of antenna is it should be a half wave long at the lowest frequency. There are various antennas like that. Your problem is that it's multi-band rather than broadband. And if it's at the lowest frequency, let's say it's 300 meters long or 150 meters long if you've got a big yard, then you will get resonances every 1 megahertz. But in between, it's not resonant, and its performance might not be what you want. So I mentioned them. They can be useful. You can use an ATU, but now automatically you would have to tune your ATU if you wanted to measure. And I think you mentioned, Dance, that you measure in 1 megahertz steps, and that means you'd have to keep tuning your ATU. Or you use a broadband transformer. Those are available. Mini circuits make them. You can make your own. You can wind your own. One big plus of these type of antennas is that they're immune to broadcast transmitters. Your SDR is not, so you might have to use filters. But the same immunity or lack of immunity that your SDR has, any low noise preamplifier on your antenna has. So the antenna in itself is immune to broadcast transmitters. It becomes your receiver's problem then. There are a number of those available. There's one that's touted a lot. The one they talk about, these unruns, the 9 to 1 unrun. And it works quite nicely. That company, Baylen Designs, they sell these things, and they've got a table, and two common ones, 53 foot long and 124 foot long. I've got the meters of that on the next page. But that will give you multi-band performance, down to, I think, 80 meters. What they don't tell you, for the thing to actually work properly, the overall length should be halfway. So if you use a counterpoise on that one at 9 foot, which is 3 meters roughly, then it'll work for 80 meters. That's already quite a big antenna, 125 feet, let's say. It's on the next page. My mental is not that
high. 40
meters?
Yeah, okay. There's an antenna tuner article which I put here simply because for illustration. They use a 51 foot, they use a 16 foot counterpoise. And they use an antenna tuner with it, but it'll work quite well without. And by the way, I've used this antenna on 40 meters, works beautifully, with just a transformer.
Sorry, can you maybe explain counterpoise?
In other words, any antenna has got to be referenced to something. In a dipole, you've got the two halves, and the one, they both radiate, but the one half is using the other one as an earth. Correct. If it's balanced, you're feeding it with the baler, and then obviously they're both being driven by the baler. But the one antenna element acts as a counterpoise to the other. When you're talking about a vertical above ground, for argument's sake, you've got to connect to the ground, and that's generally not so easy, and not very effective. What works quite well then is to put a piece of wire on, just above the ground or close to the ground or so high above the ground, doesn't really matter. They call that loosely a counterpoise. Now it's basically just the ground return path for the current.
So in that case, that third one, or do you just throw it on the ground, that basically that length?
I would not usually throw it on the ground for the simple reason the ground detunes it. Okay. You want the overall length to be halfway.
So you sort of want it at the same height as the actual wire?
Better if you can.
Okay.
But what is sort of quietly not said about this thing, these things are actually just an off-center fed dipole.
Yeah, I was just going to say. Yeah.
It's an off-center fed dipole, and by feeding it off-center, you're able to use every harmonic.
Yeah. Okay.
Whereas if you feed it in the center, you can only use odd harmonics.
Correct.
So these things are nothing but an off-center fed
dipole.
Right, and that is what you can expect from that 80-meter version. That one, 124 foot, that thing. That is the sort of impedance match across the band. You can see it resonates at places. In between, it's not too bad. Yeah, you could probably use it for receiving as well because it's not too far off. Here I'm using a 9-to-1 transformer, and that will work. Maybe not so good over there either. So it'll work, but not everywhere. Which is why, from that point of view, I discounted, one of the reasons I discounted for noise measurements. It's too variable. But this is the bigger reason why I discounted. If you take, at 80 meters, that's a half wave dipole. So it looks like a dipole. At 10 meters, that's what the pattern looks like. So now suddenly you've got a thing that's fairly directional in one direction. In fact, I think it's in that direction that is. It's fairly directional, but yeah, very, very bad nulls and peaks. So as a calibrated measurement tool, if you had a noise source that was sitting there on 10 megs, it would sound pretty insignificant maybe. But when you go to half the frequency, that peak there might be sitting there. And now suddenly it's very strong. And that will also move. So all in all, it's not really a calibrated way of measurement, but it's useful for listening. So don't discount it as a useless antenna, it's not. But not if you want to do noise measurements. So those are the long wire type solutions. I think you mentioned as well stringing it around the house or something like that. They'll all suffer from the same sort of problem. Different, but the same sort of
problem. But you can string it around the house.
Yeah, you can. But it'll probably reduce these nulls a bit. But it won't do much for the impedance problem.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to try and match that impedance to 50 ohms, more or less, to be able to work into your receiver. So long wires, yes, but not for full coverage, not for broadband use. So now, just to summarize on that, the pattern varies significantly, the impedance varies significantly. It is immune to broadcast interference, which is lovely. And you can use it with antenna tuners and. What I'm trying to say is not really for noise measurements, but for other purposes, it's a good antenna. In fact, many of us cut our teeth on these type of antennas. Well, antenna tuner, piece of wire out the window, and you were a shortwave listener before the days of SDR, but that's what you were doing. So a good general purpose antenna. Now to come to the only other option that I've actually found that will work is active antennas. Now, this guy, Martin, I forget his surname, G8 Juliet, it's difficult on the tongue. That's his website. Please take note of it. That is probably the best website I've come across for active antennas. He does a lot of other things, by the way, but he's got one section that's devoted purely to active antennas. These notes should be available afterwards on where the input comes.
MZSA.org.
Yeah. So you'll be able to get the PowerPoint and the whatever from there, and the various reference articles that I'm quoting here. Okay, he gives you some guidelines and background. He says active antennas can provide very good receive performance from a physically small structure. Now, why from a physically small structure? Your antenna signal is going to be weak. The reason for that is the background noise is high. And once you've reached the background noise, there's no point in going to a bigger antenna. You just want to be 10 or 12 dBs above background noise. And after that, you get no real benefit in terms of intelligibility. What you probably will get is stronger signal. But stronger signal doesn't always help you. In terms of intelligibility, as soon as your antenna is big enough to effectively compete with the background noise. Now, in practice, for a vertical monopole, approximately a meter, about that, 1 meter, you've already reached the background noise levels of your environment. And going any higher than that will increase your signal strength, but it won't necessarily increase your signal-to-noise ratio. And signal-to-noise ratio is what your ear hears. And so from a reception point of view, you don't benefit by going to the big antennas. The other things you benefit, you can beam power in one direction when you're beaming. And that increases your transmit signal. But for receive purposes, it doesn't help going on. And you will very often find that you can receive on an active antenna standing in your backyard on the pool fence, mine is on the pool fence, as well as you can on the antenna at the top of the beam. The signal strength is much weaker, but the signal to noise ratio is about equivalent, as long as your amplifier is designed properly. Okay, so. That sort of puts that thing in perspective. That's for a 1 meter width, is sort of in that region. And a 1 meter loop is probably the same sort of field. He says, however, there are some design constraints, and these are important ones. Firstly, the impedance of that antenna is not 50 ohms, not by a long shot. And you've got to get that power that whatever you receive on that antenna, you've got to get into your receiver. So you've got to match that antenna to your 50 ohm receiver. You need low noise amplification, but you don't need to go more than about 10 dBs below the noise floor. And that's where those curves that I showed you earlier. So as long as you're about 10 dBs below, 6 dBs or so, okay. You're going to lose a little bit, but at 10 dBs below the noise floor, you are losing half a dB in signal to noise ratio. Not a heck of a lot. So you can go up to 20, and then it's negligible. But that's the sort of ballpark to aim for. So that would depend on how you select your active elements, transistors, FETs, whatever you're using, that your noise levels are suitable. Your bigger problem is good power handling. To avoid intermodulation distortion and the production of unwanted spurious. Now, there are two forms that happen here. Let's take your medium wave station, 702 kilohertz, specifically because it's the big one here. If your receiver is nonlinear, it will double and triple and five times in the receiver front end. That is typically what they call second order distortion. So you'll get a signal at 1.4 kilohertz, megahertz, and you'll get another one every 700 kilohertz going up through the band. That's if you get distortion in your receiver. So you've got to either filter it out so it doesn't get into your receiver, and as I mentioned, if it gets into your antenna or it gets into your SDR, it's going to do the same thing. So you've got to make sure that both can deal with this situation. And quite frankly, if you want to measure HF, filter out the medium frequencies, medium wave, just filter them out, because they are really big signals. So avoid intermodulation distortion, one way is to filter it out. The other way is you've got to design for an amplifier that can actually take big signals. The other form of distortion you get, of course, is where you get two relatively closely spaced signals, let's say a megahertz apart, but they will produce a third order distortion is twice the one minus the other one, twice the other one plus. But the fact of the matter is if they're 1 megahertz apart, every 1 megahertz you're going to see these spurious signals. And they will appear like noise. And if you're trying to measure noise, they will appear as noise lines and you're going to measure them incorrectly. So that's a good reason for minimizing that. And incidentally, and that's why, for example, if you're on your own property and you're transmitting, and there's another guy up the block, and he's also transmitting, you're going to get these noise lines every few kilohertz right across a very wide range if your front end starts to distort. Good reason for turning off your own transmitter when you're making measurements, because the measurements during that time will probably be wrong. If you don't block the front end of this of your receiver, you're going to cause distortion. Right, Martin's website. Strong signal handling is the main issue with low noise amplifiers. You can make power amplifiers that will take this signal, 100 watts, not a problem, but then it's usually not low noise. So for a low noise amplifier, strong handling is your biggest difficulty. It's actually quite easy to make a low noise amp, but one that will take big signals is not so easy.
Just something, could you not solve that problem by just having two diodes in the front? So when you get long, strong signals, you don't actually have to worry about this, so you're just going to...
That will prevent blocking.
Yeah.
But the diodes themselves will do exactly that.
Okay.
They will multiply those two signals together.
Oh, okay.
It's a multiplication process.
Okay.
So it's exactly the same as you use diodes in a mixer.
Yeah.
To mix. Those okay. two, you'll get mixing at your front end.
Okay.
They do it, and that's to protect the front end.
Yes.
But it's one of the things that they do all kinds of tricks to try and avoid causing that thing to saturate.
Yeah, I was just thinking that if you use it on the front end of your preamp here, a DC will protect some of the influences of the adjacent channels. Won't it help? But you reckon it will actually not?
It will protect against damage.
Only that.
Damage
it's not going to help with...
The fact of the matter is if you don't filter the signals out,
okay.
In the first place, they find a non-linear place in the amplifier. So if you've got an amplifier chain, your low noise amp here, and then a receiver here, if this thing doesn't saturate, because it's got gain, this thing is likely to saturate.
Okay.
Then the only way really to get it out is to filter it,
okay.
Or to design both. And unfortunately, SDR has got that problem.
Yeah.
So if you start getting too much gain at the front end, you're going to run into difficulties with that as well. Or you would have a tuning tracking filter. Oh, that's expensive.
They used to, when you looked at beverage antennas for 160 meters, years ago they used to recommend you put in not a high power transmitting tube, but a sort of relatively low power transmitting tube as your receive amplifier.
Yes.
Just to cope with the high levels of signals that are coming on a beverage.
Exactly the same problem here, because it's a very broadband antenna. In fact, it's a low frequency version of the long wave wire antenna.
Yeah.
And so it's going to pick up a lot of signals, and if they start multiplying in that amplifier, then they produce spurious signals, which look like signals, and they'll even sound like a signal. If you go and multiply one signal with another one, and you listen to the product, depending on which product you're looking at, you can actually demodulate it with your ear. It sounds perfect, but it's not the right signal. Okay, so spearing was not easy to detect by this means. So that is actually your biggest difficulty. So don't have too much gap. And if you can, filter out as much as possible. The next thing he mentions here on his website, the performance is determined by the height of the antenna above the ground. If you can get it away from the ground, you get more signal, more noise as well. That's more or less what we want to, and in terms of the realms of what we're trying to do here, you're not likely to put it too high. So get a bit of height above the ground. But the other thing that's also a problem is unwanted noise coupling into the antenna. Now, that coax that runs from your antenna out in the backyard into your house carries all the noise from your house to the antenna. And you've got to stop that. We'll have a look at ways of dealing with that. And your monopole antenna specifically is more sensitive to that. The reason is not obvious, it's not because it's a monopole. The reason is because then the coax cable feeding it is part of its antenna. So if that antenna comes into your house, the cable, which it does, it's part of the antenna and it will pick up noise in the house. So just be aware of that problem, it's not trivial. Unwanted noise coupling into it. Because again, that's your house is then going to dominate the measurement, it's not external measurements you make, it's your own house. Okay, this is a simple example of an antenna. A 1 meter monopole. Typically, it needs to be much smaller than the wavelength, and for HF, 1 meter is a typical one you'll encounter. I've seen smaller ones even, like that. But what they, and it gets mentioned later, but what they don't tell you, that thing's actually sitting on a pole. So overall, sort of the order of a meter high. What you want is a high input impedance. I'll come to later why you want a high input impedance and a low noise buffer. Now, that animal there, the J310 or the U310, is an old fit. You still get them. Very good, high quality fit there. MPF 102, that sort of animal will also work. 2N4416 should also work there. It's reasonable in terms of signal handling, so it won't just saturate. And the way you're using it here, you're using it as a follower. So it's a buffer, source follower. So there's no voltage gain. So you're not getting amplification to make your noise handling or your strong signal handling problem worse. But this is a simple circuit, so it's not perfect. And then you need to get that impedance there to 50 ohms to drive your receiver. And that's what that thing is. If you have a look at that transistor, 25109, that is a TO5 power transistor. So it will give you a watt or so, if I remember correctly, half a watt transistor. I've seen them using quad twos over there, doing double two, double two. But the bigger that transistor is, the less likely you are to get intermodulation distortion here. You could get intermodulation distortion in either one of these two. But because this thing has got to drive 50 ohms, it's got to be able to give the current. And if it can't give the current, then it saturates. And when it saturates, you've got distortion again. So okay, this is a simple amplifier. And there's a 1 meter whip. It's a Dutch article, this. That's a reference to it. PA0 something or other. I forget his call sign. Come to it. But that's an example of a simple circuit using his thing. And you can build that quite easily. Work tolerably well. Incidentally, you'll see here that the coax running to the house goes on here, and they actually run the DC through that to supply that. So you need a bit of a choke there to tap off the DC. That makes the power supply for this thing 12 volts or so, 45 milliamps. You see it's drawing a bit of current, these things. The reason for that is to prevent intermodulation distortion. And you will typically find anything that can deal with high power will draw current capacity. So unfortunately, expect to be able to supply a bit of current. And if you're not careful with your design, like for example, you can change that transistor to something else. Let's say you put a quad 2 there. It won't have quite the power handling capability, but if you don't look at the biasing, you might burn it out. So rethink the biasing if you're going to change it. That's not such an easy transistor to get hold of these days. A 2N3866 will do the same job. So just keep in mind the power handling of that transistor if you want to duplicate this circuit. Okay, that's that guy there. That's one of his circuits, and that's the article. It's in the set of stuff. That one article P80RDT mini book edition. You can go and read it. He's got a number of things. He's got how he developed the thing, and you can copy his circuits. He's got better circuits than that as well. So you can have a look at it. And those two articles there give some extra background and improvements on his antenna. So those are I don't have those articles as articles. You're gonna have to go and get them off the net. They were linked on the Martin G, what's it, whatever, that website. But the links didn't work. Those links, last time I looked, didn't work. So I went and found where the articles are, and those are the correct links. One of these articles, I forget which one, describes how these antennas work. And this is a picture from that. What you're seeing here is, in effect, that antenna is sampling the electric field. These are electric field lines, and this is the ground. And that gap there is where your amplifier sits. And that's where it shows you that this, the pole that the antenna is standing on is actually part of the antenna. It's connected to ground. It's not directly connected, at least capacitively coupled or something. But it's connected to ground, and you're actually sampling the field. And that's why the higher you can get away from the ground, the longer that pole is. And that gives you a longer sample of the electric field. You're measuring over a bigger area. I will come back to that concept, by the way. The longer that pole is, why you get more signal. But, so the length of that pole, even if you've got a plastic pole, you say, well, the plastic pole is not conductive. It isn't. But your coax is conductive. The coax that runs back to your house. And that is why the coax is actually part of the antenna. Even if it's not, especially if it's not grounded there. Anything that gets into it here, the receiver form, the interference noise, will couple straight in and bang, it's in your antenna. So you actually want to make sure that whatever happens along this line, it chokes off any noise in the house. And there you can see they put in chokes, ground it if you can. There are various options I get, but if you're picking up noise and you don't know where the devil is coming from, start here. There you can see how the British guy, Martin, suggests you do it. He actually builds choke antennas like that, grounds them in between, he runs the coax from one to the other. Now, that obviously forms a low-pass filter, that's grounded there, and chokes in between. And he does a lot of work to make sure that he's got that kind of protection. Otherwise, you're measuring your house's noise. That's a 240. 240 is a 2.5-inch core, 2.4-inch. So that's at 60 millimeters, that sort of order. It's a big core. And it's that 77, I can't remember what that ferrite is, but it's a high mu ferrite. If you can't get that, I'm sure if you find any low-frequency ferrite, you just wind a lot of turns on it. At least you'll get a choking action. Okay, so that's how he builds his chokes. But be aware that's an issue. Now,
was he using coax on his choke?
Yeah, that's a big. As I say, that's a 2.4-inch choke, so it's a big ferrite.
How readily available is that type of coax?
I don't know that one offhand, RG179, that's the 2.5 millimeter stuff. You can pick one.
I find around a while back, and half the guys don't even know what you're talking about.
Your average electronic shop one. RG174 is very commonly used on GPS antennas. That might be more readily available. That's 179, which is 75 ohm current. So yeah. You can use 50 ohms. I'd in fact use 50 ohms. But the fact of the matter is, RG174, it's a cheap coax. The nasty thing about it's got polyethylene insulation, which means when you get it hot, it melts. So you just got to work carefully with it. That one is probably different. But RG179, it's a thin coax. It's about Oh, your typical GPS antenna.
Yeah, we used to use it for instruments and stuff.
174. You get the better quality Teflon ones as well, but 174 did the job. Okay. I've mentioned in that article that they use FETs as the buffer. The other ways of doing it. And this particular, I'm giving you this article simply to show you. It'd be interesting to go and try and build it, actually. But non-faster impedance wideband matching techniques for electrically small active antennas. Nice article. He's got a fairly decent what you call analysis of his circle. And he's got distortion measurements. And he uses op-amps. If you use a low noise op-amp, specifically a FET input op-amp, and there are a lot of really low noise ones available. One of the ones that was commonly used was the OPA-111. That's relatively noisy compared to some of these. The OP-27, I think it is. This is considerably better. And then these things are modern animals. They have got noise levels that are the same order as a FET, a single FET like that U310. Some of their data is available there. I'm putting it out because I'd actually like to play with this. I haven't tried it, but I'd like to play with these. But there's the circuit using an OP657. I don't know what the one stands for because it's actually the 657 that he's using. It's a Texas Instruments animal. Okay, and then he does this whole analysis, and he's got the noise analysis, and then he does noise measurements, where he tells you what the performance of this thing. So it's measures, not just theory. So that article is in there. You can have a look at it. I'm pointing it out because I would actually like to use it in a different thing, which we'll come to shortly. But in fact, we're just coming to a new approach to active antenna design by this chap, Nordholt, and another chap. We're going to be students. It's a Dutch guy. And then you was in 1980. The article is in the IEEE of 1980. Copy of it is in there. By the way, those numbers are the article references. He uses a transimpedance amplifier, and he's got very, very, very good measured performance results. And the circuit is incomplete. If you look at the circuit, my friend of France, that is called Fosker, is now in the States. I haven't spoken to him about it, but he tried to build that thing. And I suspect if he tried to build it from that, he abandoned it, because the one he actually built in the end used this PC board, and it's not the same one as that. I've discovered another article by this chap, Rollema, also Dutch, and he gives you the full circuit. That is the full circuit. And the piece that's missing is that cap. Feedback capacitor. What this guy is doing, this is a low impedance input. I've mentioned previously that you use a high impedance input. This is a low impedance input. So what he's doing is he says, well, the antenna is a rod and it's a capacitor, and he uses that capacitor to balance the effect of the rod. And the advantage of having a low impedance here is that diode doesn't saturate. Protection diode. Because now that thing is at a low impedance point, so it doesn't saturate. These are Meniere transistors, these. They're not little things. And if you have a look here, there's a feedback resistor. Where is it? That one. It's a 10 gigohm feedback resistor. Where the heck you find that, I don't know, but my friend apparently found it. He sourced it. You put a lot of 10 meg resistors in series, you can make yourself. At any rate, a friend of mine at work always refers to that kind of thing. He says it's a calibrated open circuit. Okay, so you're going to battle to find that. If you can't find that and you want to build this thing, you're probably going to firstly have to replace the transistors with modern equivalents. I think U310 will work there quite well. But that determines the low frequency response. This antenna goes down to 5 kHz, and you don't want that for SDR measurements. But the measured performance of this thing is superb. I don't have it on my fingertips, but it's in the article. Again, he feeds the power through the coax to it and what have you. Okay, very nice circuit there, very interesting article to read, if nothing else. Because he does the fuller noise analysis and what have you. Coming back to Martin G8 J&J, my tongue doesn't work around that one, but anyway. Right at the start of his website, he puts this one as being the best monopole, active monopole circuit that he's ever tried, and it's extremely simple. That animal you can buy from the mini circuits representatives in Pretoria. Unfortunately, you've got to buy 20 at a shop. I was lucky the other day, they had to bring in 30 for somebody, and having to buy 20 at the time, they had 10 spare. So I bought the 10 remaining ones. They cost about 40 rand each. And he suggests you buy two at a time, because he says they're fragile, they break quite easily if you mess it up. But this is just built on a piece of tin plate or piece of PC board. You see, he soldered the regulators and what have you. That is a microwave, VHF microwave amplifier. It's not designed for HF use. And it's in fact unstable at HF. But the reason he says it works pretty well is the impedance is extremely high. I'll come to why you want high impedance here later. That high impedance below 50 megahertz is why they don't specify below 50 megahertz. And you sometimes have to take care about making it stable. It can be unstable. But it seems this circuit is stable. At 40 rand a pop, and you want to buy a spare one, so 80 rand. And in terms of simplicity, that is the simplest circuit I've come across. And this guy says it's the best performance that he's yet come across. So if you want to do something quickly, I have got 10 of them, and I'm not going to make any profit on them, so if anybody wants to buy some, you're welcome. I'm not likely to use 10. I know some of the guys at work want to use some of them as well, for this purpose, also for amplifiers. So I'd like to try this. But if one wants to put together a batch and buy 20 at a time, it's not a heck of a lot of money. And yeah, nice circuit there.
And those diodes on the input?
Again, those things will saturate.
Is that for protection?
Yeah. And by the way, if you have a look, that's why he's putting them multiple diodes to make them bigger voltage before they start to saturate, because that will cause distortion. Mm. But he says overall the performance of this is the best one he's built a lot.
You didn't have that J310, the first one I think you had.
Mm-hmm.
If you would compare that to this one, which one do you think this one is better?
I'm pretty sure this is better.
Because I bought that J310 one and it didn't look so well. So I'm not sure. Maybe a mistake I made is I didn't have isolation. The car is coming down, so I was pushing, I think, a lot of noise back up.
Yeah.
But yeah, maybe I must try this one.
Those are your two problems, pushing noise back up the car,
yeah,
and strong signal handling.
And I'm probably going to have the same problem here. You need to have the isolation at the bottom.
Those chokes that I showed you from this guy's website. So he uses it with us. It's one of the disadvantages of the monopole. Speak a bit later about the alternative, but just be aware of it. It's not the end of the world. You can bury the guy if it comes to that. That will also give you a lot of protection. And your wife might not like you digging holes in her lawn, but yeah. And if you do bury it deep enough, because somebody will stick a fork through it. Okay. The website of Martin has got a lot of different references on. I've put some of them here. Kits, that one with the J310, there are improvements on it. That was one of his simpler early designs. There are improvements on it, and they do offer kits for it. So you can get kits. Obviously, you're going to have to bring it from Europe. That's where they advertise the kits. That goes sort of together with it. This guy makes the improvements. It's one of those articles I referenced. This guy, Clifton Labs, he sold that company, and it's now been taken over by... So you battle to find that manual, because the minute you go to Clifton Labs, it takes you to the main one, and that manual's disappeared. But he's got a fairly... Apparently it works very well. So there's a circuit which you can go and copy if you want to. This guy's got some interesting circuits as well. Offhand, I can't remember what, but he's got a lot of construction techniques. And that's one of the reasons why I've listed some of these. Shows you ways of constructing, putting the thing together, because waterproof, putting it outside, choking it off, all those kind of things are issues. Nail, sort of background information you can pick out of those articles. These are not in the data pack I've given you, you're going to have to go and get them. That one is. That one is there, I'm pretty sure. I've got it at any rate. I just haven't referenced it specifically. And then this one here, he's got a whole lot of different circuits, including the simpler FET ones, and the more complicated FET ones where he uses them in push-pull to improve the strong signal handling. Because when you run them in push-pull, you cancel second order distortion. And second order distortion is typically, like for example, if you've got a 1 meg transmitter, it'll double, or 4 times, or 6 times in the amplifier. And second order distortion gets cancelled by push-pull amplifiers. So this is a very nice guy's a hamburger, I forget his call sign, W7 something. He writes quite a lot of articles. This one I think is in the IEEE. So reasonably good quality articles and a whole range of different circuits. All of which vary from fairly simple to fairly complicated. The disadvantage of probably some of them is he winds those transformers by hand and getting the ferrites can be a nuisance. Source of ferrites here. Leon, LML? No, Leon and Linda. They've got a lot of the ferrites, so you could contact them. Otherwise you can buy them from Amador.
Cape Town as well, he keeps all the rest.
One X.
One X, yeah.
It's Quivers.
Quivers, yeah.
Yeah, One X. Okay, so that's a source of ferrites if you want to wind your own transformers and stuff. But I've got a feeling you can get away with mini circuits for a lot of these things, because a lot of them are 9 to 1, 16 to 1, 4 to 1. That you can get from Pretoria. Used to be Tadi Remmerman's company, by the way. What was it?
What was it? Yeah, somebody else that has the.
What was Tadi's call sign?
AOG.
AOG. He ran what was the mini circuits representatives. There's now a guy in Pretoria who's got that agency. I want to come on to before we walk away from the monopoles, I've got a little bit more to say about them, but those are the sort of circuits I found. I've got, incidentally, one, I didn't get it copied at home, didn't connect to the printer, so I'll scan this and send it as well. This is a circuit that my friend built. I don't think it's a high performance circuit. It's also FET input, and it uses T1, what is T1? BFW's 10, 2N3823, which is not far different from a 2N4416. It's that sort of ilk, so I would put a U310 in there. It draws about 40 milliamps. That's what I'm using at home at the moment. My friend at that stage built a lot of PC boards, and he gave me a couple. The one doesn't have the ground plane on it, that one. But he then left for America and he gave me that, so I never built it, so I've still got his antenna. Works quite well. I don't think it's as good a quality in terms of performance as that thing. But as I say, I think he tried to build it before he knew that thing, about that capacitor. This is a real monster. It draws a lot of current, runs of 30 volts. So it's the highest performance numbers I've seen on any amplifier, this description. Okay. The second type of active antenna I want to talk about is the loop. The monopole, as I mentioned, is about a meter long. That's the ilk. And it has a pattern, the monopole, which is omnidirectional. So it's 360 degrees if it's standing vertically. And in effect, it's sampling the E field, the electric field, the E field. The alternative is a small loop, and the loop must stand vertically. In other words, if it's a loop, it's like that. If you lay it horizontally, it's short-circuited by the ground, in effect, because it's now horizontally polarized. You lose massive sensitivity. That thing needs to stand upright. When it stands upright, this is looking at it from the top. Unfortunately, it's got a figure eight pattern. There is a way of working around that, but it's a figure eight pattern, so it's got a null in that direction. So for noise measurements, it's not the end of the world because you know where it is. It's there. It's at the right angles to the antenna. And there is a workaround. But keep that in mind. If you don't do the workaround, it's a figure eight pattern, and it picks up in the direction of the loop.
And roughly how big is the loop?
About a meter. Mm-hmm. The typical ones you would buy are 600 millimeters in diameter, and they cover from 100 kilohertz all the way up to 30 megahertz. There's a Rudder and Swartz sample, if you want to go buy it for a lot of money. Rudder and Swartz make them. I used them in England at one stage, doing 100 kilohertz measurements. Very nice antenna, but at a price.
Sorry, may I just ask Anton a question? Yeah. This whole monitoring process, surely we want directional to actually determine which direction your interference is, or do you want to just have general interference?
I would say it has to be omnidirectional. This will be fantastic once you start hunting interference.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that what we're trying to hunt down eventually? To pinpoint where the interference is coming from? No.
No.
So you're looking at the general monitor. Okay, fine. Yeah.
Well, that's point one, yeah. Maybe ultimately you need to go to yours.
For DF, is it? That is the classic DF antenna. In terms of pattern, figure eight, keep that in mind. But there is a workaround. I'll come to that shortly. If I forget, remind me. It's a very simple workaround. First thing, before I move on, I'd like to speak about effective height. If you've got an electric field in this area, and you put up an antenna, and you're measuring that field, you've got an open circuit on it, not into 50 ohms now. If you get an open circuit voltage, whatever it happens to be, the effective height of that antenna is the height that will, when it's multiplied by the electric field, equal that voltage. Okay. So in effect, you can say, if I've got a field of 1 volt per meter, meters about that, eh? If I've got a 1 meter rod, and it's got an effective height of 1 meter, then I will get 1 volt at the end of it. The problem is a rod, the current in it isn't uniform. If you had uniform current in that rod, then the physical height of the antenna would equal the effective height. The effective height for a rod is half of it. So a 1 meter rod has got an effective height of half a meter. So it will measure a 1 volt per meter field as half a volt. That's all this effective height is about. If you wanted it to be 1 meter long, you put a capacitor hat on top. So you light which is equal to its physical height. And a lot of your EMI antennas, measurement antennas, if you see them, it's a rod with a disc on the top. That's all they're trying to do. So physically, and that height, by the way, includes the pole that it's standing on. Now that Dutch article that I mentioned, he uses a very short rod on top of a standing rod. It's because once you've induced that, he uses a fat capacitor on the end. So he's trying to make the current equal through the rod. So that's why he's measuring near the top. But he uses a fat, broad, flat capacitor. Effectively, he's using a capacitor hat and measuring at the top because the current is the same everywhere. But the effective height is really, for a monopole, pretty much the height of the antenna, or half of it, depending on the current. For a small loop, and by the way, that's independent of frequency. So at 1 meg or at 30 megs, it's almost insignificant, the difference. It's pretty constant. And it's because it's small, it's short. If it's long, like a dipole, different story. Current is no longer. It's not that the current isn't uniform. In a short thing, it's triangular. In a full-size dipole, it's sine wave. Because of that, the effective height of a dipole is longer. But the bottom line is, it's a short monopole, and about a meter height, then you'll find that it's half of its height. For a small loop, that is the effective height. It's 2 pi divided by the wavelength times the area of the loop. So one by one by one loop, it would be 1 square meter. That would be, so it'd be about 6 divided by the wavelength. So at 30 megs, you'd have 6 meters divided by 10 meters. So your effective height would be about that big for a loop. But at 1 meg, it becomes 6 divided by 300. So a loop has not got a constant output voltage relative to frequency, like the monopole. And we said we wanted an antenna that's, that you can measure with. Now, you know that thing, so you can measure with it still. So, and you will find amplifiers where you have to give consideration to that. But there is a way of getting a constant output. If you take a monopole, it's got an open circuit voltage, and it's in series with a capacitor. The capacitor is the physical capacitance of that rod. It's small, it's usually in the order of 5 or 10 picofarad. Because you, and this is why you want a high impedance amplifier, if you have a capacitor in series with an open circuit voltage of 1 volt, and the impedance is very, very high, the capacitor's impedance is neither yang nor yang. So you get the full voltage on your amplifier. And that is why most monopole antennas will have a high impedance amplifier. That Dutch guy who, from 1980, who did a different approach, his approach was to use a short circuit and compensate for that capacitor in the feedback. Okay? So he deviated from that. And there are circuits that will deviate from it. But for a monopole, high impedance, because then this, the capacitance of the thing becomes negligible. For a loop, the equivalent circuit is that open circuit voltage, which if you convert to frequency, looks like that. 2 pi the frequency divided by the C is the speed of light, yeah, not capacitance. Times the area of the loop, times the field, and that will be your open circuit voltage. However, the loop has got an inductance, just from its physical, the fact that it's a loop. And you'll notice that is 2 pi f above the line, and that's 2 pi f above the line. If you short circuit the loop, you're now looking at the short circuit current from the loop. And the short circuit current from the loop is 2 pi f divided by 2 pi f. It cancels out, you're left with the area of the loop times the field divided by the inductance and the speed of light. So in effect, the loop's effectiveness is just its area divided by inductance. And it's constant with frequency. So one way of getting the loop to be frequency independent is not to look at the voltage, it's rather look at the current. And for that, you want an amplifier that looks like a short circuit. So your what they call a Norton amplifier is a current amplifier. It multiplies the current up to something else. So it's a current amplifier instead of a voltage amplifier. Or alternatively, you want to measure voltage. So you use what they call a transimpedance amplifier. You drive that current into a load. And the load at the other end is then a voltage. And so you've converted a current to a voltage, so they call it a transimpedance amplifier. So loops typically have got transimpedance amplifiers. Any questions on that? We're going to deviate from that as well. These are, as I say, the two theoretically ideals. One is a monopole as a high impedance amplifier, and we've already seen one that deviates from it. The loop, theoretically, a transimpedance amplifier with 0 ohms input impedance. This guy, Trask, there's another article of his there, he goes into this particular article, mine, reference mine, has got some really nice amplifiers in it for loops. But this is his equivalent circuit. So it goes from the loop, it goes through the voltage. Voltage in series with the inductance, the other things parasitic related. Very small radiation resistance, but you're using it for a receiver. And then he converts it to the equivalent current source. So it's a current source in parallel with an inductor. And if you short circuit that, all that current flows in the short circuit.
So the first one is open, so the second one is short.
Yeah.
And you just, how does he measure it? With a coil around down the tube, or how would you do it?
Well, this you would put a current amplifier there and just measure the current.
Over a resistor or a...
Very strong resistor.
Okay.
Okay. So, if you remember in the days when you did the RAE, you had two equivalent circuits. A voltage equivalent circuit, which I call the Thevenin equivalent. And the other one is the current source equivalent circuit, which I call the Norton equivalent. That's the Norton equivalent, that's the Thevenin. Long time ago, that. Those are the things. So, for that, you're looking at it as open circuit, and it's not flat with frequency. For the Norton equivalent, it's flat with frequency. But it's the current that's flat, not the voltage.
To overcome the problem of the pattern, if you use two out of phase.
Loops?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's part of the workaround, but not out of phase.
Oh, okay.
I'll come to it now. In fact, very shortly. Okay, just quick reality check. I've said high impedance for a monopole and low impedance for a loop. But there are a lot of things that vary. There's more than one way to skin a cat. And we've already seen that one Dutch article. He does it differently. That the Chinese article, the one with the op-amps, he also does it differently. So not all of them follow those rules. So when you find something that's different, don't be surprised. And that very often, when you try and do that, you run into other problems. Or you try and do that, you run into other problems. And so to get around those problems, you've got to deviate from what would otherwise be ideal. Okay, this chap, I've got his article there. It's just a short form copy of his website page. But he goes through the guidelines. He says an amplifier with low input impedance, which we've just seen 3 ohms, relative to the inductance of the loop is good. Because it has to be low relative to the inductance, the reactance of the inductance. He says you want to minimize the inductance and maximize the area. Remember I said the biggest current you get is bigger area, smaller inductance. So minimize inductance, maximize the area, and you're going to get the most sensitive loop. The shape is not critical insofar as you don't affect the inductance. If you get a shape that messes around with the inductance and makes the inductance go up, then it's not good. But let's say, for example, you've got a square loop or a circular loop. It hardly affects the inductance. And so in that sense, shape is not critical. Triangular loop, octagonal loop, they all work. You just don't want to affect the inductance. So as long as you keep that in mind, it doesn't matter what the shape of the loop is. It can be rectangular as well. That will change the inductance, but sometimes that's all you can do. What he says is use only one turn. It's tempting to use multiple turns because it gives you a greater voltage. But the inductance goes up faster than the voltage goes up. So when you divide the voltage by the inductance, you're actually losing. So it's one turn only. At very low frequencies, you see multi-turn loops. It's because they're not producing enough to overcome the outside noise. So they use multi-turns there. But for HF, one turn only. And then running a swatch loop, you'll see it's just a single turn. A lot of loops, they'll tell you should screen it. Now that is valid as long as you are using high impedance amplifiers. Because now this piece of loop that's standing like it effectively looks like a monopole. And a monopole wants to see high impedance. And if you've got a high impedance amplifier there, then it will also pick up just from the wire of the loop as a monopole, look like a monopole. And so you will get a lot of extraneous measurements that it's no longer just a loop, it becomes a loop and a monopole. But when you're using a low impedance amplifier, that whatever it picks up on the loop is basically not recognized by the amplifier. Apart from the fact that your amplifier is usually balanced, because the loop is balanced. And what he also says is if you do screen it, it actually messes up your balance. So don't screen the loop if you're using a low impedance amplifier. And the crossed loops. The crossed loops does two things. It reduces the inductance. I'm not sure that actually helps you because it's not producing more signal. But it fills in that knob. So you just put the two loops in parallel. You don't phase them. You just put them in parallel with each other. And the one will radiate that way, or pick up that way, and the other one will pick up that way. Yes. It gives you a more or less omnidirectional antenna.
You'll still have a little quarters.
Yeah, it looks like a square.
Yeah.
It looks a bit like a square, that pattern. But at least it hasn't got that null anymore. This guy says it reduces the inductance. It does, but it reduces the inductance with an inductance that doesn't produce more signals. I think it's actually shorting part of the signal. So
it's an inductance that doubles the signal.
Yeah.
So it's probably
no, it doesn't double the signal because the one is picking up if it's in that direction.
Oh,
the one is picking up nothing. I'm wary of that comment. He does say you can reduce them by putting them in parallel, but in the same plane. But now then you haven't filled in the null. So that's a trade-off. By putting multiple loops in parallel, not in series with each other, you reduce the inductance so you will get better sensitivity. But if you want to fill in the null, put them at right angles to each other. So for me, that's primarily about filling the null, not reducing the inductance. And he says use thick loops as well, by the way. His article is there, so you can go and read it. I've just taken sort of the main points. He has some background information. Norton amplifier amplifies current. There's a fairly good article by this guy Langford. It's not specifically for loops, but he does talk about loops. And you could probably use them by putting a low step-down transformer at the input of these Norton amps. But it's a useful article, and it's referenced by some of the other articles, so I'll put it in. There's another loop by a company called Wellgood, which you could buy, and apparently it's a very, very good loop. The problem is if it ever dies, you can't repair it, because the thing's potted. And they'd sell you a new amplifier and fix it. So this chap, George Smart, this is a radio amp, he went and slipped one of them, and he managed to remove all the potting, and he's traced the circuit. And he's got a very, very detailed article on his website on what he found replacing the transistors with modern transistors and what have you. So that article tells you how to build one of those loops. It's not a really simple circuit, but what I've generally found is loop circuits are more complicated than monopole circuits. But I think they perform better. Maybe I'll say it why now. A loop is a balanced item. The coax that runs to your house, to get to the loop, you're going through a balun or a transformer or something like that. So it means that the rubbish that comes from the house isn't coupled into the loop. So loops, it's my opinion, are quieter in terms of house noise and easier to filter noise off the power line, off the transmission line. So my feeling is if you can build a loop, cross loop to be able to get omni reception, but that is my opinion. I haven't verified that. But at any rate, if you can build that loop, the general thing is loop amplifiers tend to be more complicated. This chap here, VK5SRP, has got some articles, and the article is there. He builds a cheap, relatively simple loop amplifier. I've seen comments somewhere else saying you can use it to keep the size of the loop small. Because it's not a particularly high technology circuit. As I said, cheap and cheerful. And it's probably a quick way to get started. Poor strong single handling, but cheap. That article is there. The one I've got the circuit diagram, I'll show you, is not the one that he finally uses. But it shows you what the structure of this thing is. The Wellgood loop by this chap Smart, George Smart, he stripped it and copied it. That is the circuit. You can see what I mean by it's more complicated. There's quite a complicated transformer structure here. You've got to wind this one yourself. You won't be able to buy it. But here you can see that the loop is isolated. So anything running on the coax coming in can't get to the loop directly. That acts as a balun. Here he's also, in effect, got a balun, but it could get there. But here, being stopped. And you'll find a lot of loop amplifiers. Sometimes they will have a balun built into here, just as a chip. Or they've got something like this.
Is that a short, that's a current loop, correct? It's not a voltage one.
Yeah, if you have a look at this, you'll see this is a common base amplifier. Common base amplifier is low noise. It has got feedback in here which pushes up the thing a bit. And he does reference that article of Chris Trost, because Chris Trost does the basic design of a lot of these things, and this amounts to that circuit. So that's the reason I've got the article of Krzyzkowski in there, where it gives you a very similar design to this. But if you have a look, it's relatively complicated. You've got these transformers which you've got to wind, but the rest of the circuit is not too difficult. But low impedance, apparently very, very good performance. The commercial version, the board versions. The website of Smart has got a very long discussion on it. He defines alternative transistors. So I haven't in detail read what his reports on the performance. I was more interested in, yeah, he's traced the circuit, so we can replicate the antenna. So nice circuit to build, but a little bit of work to do it. The simple circuit that I was referring to, this is this PK5SRP, cheap and cheerful. That, if I'm not mistaken, you can use quad twos for. He's using a BC547. I've seen it built with quad twos. 2N2222. He's drawing 100 milliamps, by the way, in that thing. So the input impedance is quite low. I'm guessing it's in the order of 50 ohms across the loop. Not as low as you'd like it, but it's a relatively low impedance. And in one of the articles I saw, they said limit the loop to about half a meter in diameter. Because it is a simple circuit.
It's a simple transformer, 5 tens.
Yeah, that. I think you just buy yourself one from mini circuits as well. 1-to-1. You get broadband transformers from mini circuits. But any piece of, well, not quite
it's
any piece.
37.43 with
T5,
so it's 5 tens, so it's easy to make.
Easy to make. So, just as a quick get started, I wouldn't mind trying building one of those. That's probably the one I will build first. Coming back to this chap, LZ1AQ, he has got a circuit with a common base push-pull amplifier. Now, if you have a look at that one, it's also common base, but it's got this bit of transforming in the front of it. LZ1AQ gave those other guidelines. He has got a simpler circuit. He has got kits available. They look jolly nice, by the way. And his kit will accommodate multiple loops. And if I remember correctly, his kit will also accommodate where you use the two loops, one of the two loops as separate elements of a monopole. In effect, that you've got a dipole there. I think his kit will do that, but not dead sure of that. And there's a lot of good background information on his website. So go and have a look at that website, if nothing else. Interesting circuits, and that is his circuit. You can see it's a common base. It's going in there. This is grounded. That's grounded. It's push-pull. He's got a bit of choking there. And a simple transformer on the output, which you can wind yourself or wire mini circuits one. But you haven't got this big complicated transformer at the front. That transformer in the other one is actually giving feedback, which helps to linear.